Father, we are so grateful we get to gather to worship you, to lift your name high, because you have made us your children. You have saved us. You have redeemed us. You have justified us. You have set us free from sin and death and given us life, not just now, but eternal. We give you praise and honor and glory. And I would pray in this moment, give us eyes to see and ears to hear and a heart to understand your word, that we would be stirred to a greater love for you, a greater understanding of who you are, and a greater hunger and thirst for righteousness this side of heaven. Work in us in these moments. We ask and we pray as we open your word. And thank you that we get to do all of this. In your great name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning. If you by chance are visiting with us, my name is John Nichols. I'm the campus pastor, and I get the privilege of opening God's word with you this morning. So I'm excited. I hope you are. And we are going to be in Acts. Okay, somebody is. I paid them, so it's all good. We're going to be in Acts chapter 3, so if you have your Bible, open it up. If you have your phone, go to your Bible app and open it up. If you don't have a Bible app, go to Google, type Acts chapter 3, and you will find where we are going to be this morning. And as you are turning there, I'm just curious, well, you may or may not have heard of them, but you've heard of missionaries at least, the idea of being a missionary, right? Somebody who goes to a foreign country usually and, you know, they spend their life or a season of life there trying to teach the indigenous people there about Christ, maybe even trying to establish a church. It's been going on for a long, long time, right? Paul and Peter were kind of the first missionaries where they began to venture out beyond Jerusalem and tell other nations and other races and other people about Jesus. And it's still going on today. Some of you probably have friends who are missionaries. Maybe some of you were missionaries. Two of the most famous ones that I've learned about in my lifetime. One is a woman named Amy Carmichael. I'm not sure if you've heard of her, but if you haven't, you need to. She spent the latter part of the 1800s and the early 1900s in India. She was a British woman who spent close to 70 years in the mission field, 50 to 60 of which were in India, working with children that were in danger. And she built an amazing ministry, rescuing and reaching these children. But she did an amazing job. And like she said, she spent her life there. She was touched by the Lord at an early age and said, I'm going to India and I'm going to risk my life. She was never married, never had her own family, but she made these children her family and her ministry. Another name that's probably a little more famous or maybe more well-known is a man named Jim Elliot or Nate Saint. They were a group of five men who went to Ecuador in the 1950s. And if you've ever heard their story, right, they were five men who wanted to reach a tribe that was still primitive. They had never been reached, and anybody who had ever even tried to go meet them or see them had been killed previously, but they felt the call of the Lord to go try and reach this tribe. And all five of those men would not just risk their lives, they would be martyred by this tribe. Now, just so you know, the beautiful part of the end of that story is that their wives would eventually lead this tribe to Christ. Why do I share all this? Because I don't know about you, but growing up, I came to know Christ when I was 14, and I started hearing about missionaries, some of whom would risk their lives. I have friends today that are in Turkey, and their communications have to be private because where they are, they could be martyred for the gospel. They've been there for 20 years. I don't know about you, but I've kind of always had this prayer like, Lord, I'll go wherever. Just don't call me outside the U.S. I don't know if you've ever had that thought, like missionaries are great, Lord, just please don't call me there. Don't call me to Africa. Don't call me to the Middle East, Lord. I'm going to support him and pray for him, but don't call me there. But not even that. So often we think of missionaries as people who are somehow more, I mean, they've been called. You're a missionary. So here's the thing. Here's what I'm getting at. Folks, we're all missionaries. And I don't say that lightly. That's like, oh, of course, John. Yeah, we're all. No, we all are called as missionaries. We are all called and we are all placed exactly where the Lord wants us. He doesn't want you in Africa. You're here. He doesn't want you in the Middle East. You're here. As we've been saying in the book of Acts, we are all witnesses. And that's simply what a missionary is. A missionary is someone who is a witness who's gone somewhere else, we often think. But you don't have to go somewhere else to be on mission or to be a witness. If you are a child of God here this morning, you are a missionary. You are a witness for Christ. And we can learn a lot from the people in Acts as we read the book of Acts. Read the book of Acts, right? It's the building of the church. It's the men and women going out on mission. Some would go to other people groups. Some would go to other nations, but many would just live every day where they were and go out on mission. And so what we want to do this morning is kind of look at a day in the life. A day in the life of early Christians and what it looked like, and learn from them maybe what we can do today, where we are, without having to go anywhere else, whether you live in Lake in the Hills or Algonquin or Crystal Lake or any one of the other towns around us. Maybe look at what a day in the life of one of us should maybe look like in the towns and the neighborhoods and the subdivisions that we live in. Let's just remember the setting here, right? In Acts chapter 2, Peter preaches the first sermon. 3,000 get saved, and they start living in what we would probably call home churches, right? They didn't have a building. They couldn't use the temple. So they would meet in groups in homes, and they would share meals. They would take communion. They would study the Bible, or at least what they had, the apostles' letters in the Old Testament. They would pray together. And we're told that the last verse of chapter 2, right? The Lord added to their day, added to their number day by day those who were being saved. That's the last verse in chapter 2. The Lord was adding to their number. We always think, oh, that's a great description of the church. But do you ever stop and ask how? Was it just magical that they just sat there and people who didn't know Jesus just kept walking into their homes? No, he did it through them. They weren't done. The church didn't stop it like, oh, we got 3,000, we're good. We're just going to ride the wave of what Jesus does. No, God would add to their number daily through their efforts and through their works. And so that's what we're going to learn from this morning, right? We talked the last 2 weeks about these marks of a healthy church, and now we're going to see them live them out day by day. And we're going to learn from that what we can do, how we can live as missionaries on every given day. So Acts chapter 3, verse 1 says this, "Now Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour." Right? So Peter and John, right there, they're now Christians. Yes, they grew up Jewish. Why would they still be going to the temple? We know we read in Acts chapter 2, they would continue to go to the temple. Now we're being told they would do that. Why would they go there? Well, some of the details are in the verse. They were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. What does that mean? Well, three times a day, the Jewish people would gather at the temple for prayer. The third, the sixth, and the ninth hour, which really means 9 a.m., noon, and 3 p.m. That's when they would gather. They're going up at 3 p.m. in the afternoon. Why 3 p.m.? Why not 9 a.m.? Well, we also know from history that twice a day there were sacrifices made at the temple, and 3 p.m. was one of those times. So 3 p.m. would have been the most crowded time at the temple. So again, why would they be going there? Well, we know from the rest of chapter 3, chapter 4, and chapter 5, they were going there to proclaim the gospel, right? That's why they were going there. This is what they were doing. Hey, 3,000 came to know Jesus. Great. We've got them all in home churches. Great. But there are tens of thousands more who don't yet know Jesus. Let's go to them. Let's go to where they are and try to engage them and tell them too about Jesus Christ. And they would do this day by day, we're told in chapter 2. Peter and John went with a purpose, folks. They were going to where the lost were. And this is the first thing we learn from them. This is the first thing we see in their day. And it's the thing that we learn from them is simply this, that witnesses go to lost people. If we are all witnesses, just like they are, they go to lost people. We should go to lost people. We can't wait for them to walk in our doors. They didn't wait for lost people to knock on their doors and say, "Can I come in for dinner? I want to hear about what's going on here." Maybe that happened. But they intentionally and purposely went to where the lost would be. They knew that at 3 p.m. in the temple, they would have, this is the largest crowd they could find. And they wanted to talk to the largest crowd they could possibly find. All right, let's not forget the Great Commission, right? Go and make disciples. That's what they were going to do. They were going to go to where the disciples were, where the lost were. Let me ask you this question. Whatever town you live in, whatever neighborhood you live in, where do crowds of lost people hang out? Might be different in every town. Are there favorite hangout spots? From what I can see on Facebook, I know in the summer, Crystal Lake, the lake, is a huge place. There seems to be so much going on there, so many events. But where else, maybe in your town? What comes to mind? What do you know of? Where do the people hang out? Maybe that's where we should be hanging out, just like Peter and John. No, this next Sunday is Halloween. You know, when I was growing up, and I think this is still pretty true for kids, but our kids are long since out of the house, but when I was growing up, right, there was this kind of one unwritten rule you knew, right? Your goal is to get as much candy as you could, right? And I carried a pillowcase. Forget the little orange pumpkin. I wanted to fill up that pillow. I was going out till the pillowcase was full and I wasn't coming home. And there was one unwritten rule. Where do you go? You go to the houses who have their light turned on, right? The porch light's on, go get candy. The porch light's not on, you don't go get candy. And so you would look for every house. And I admit when I got older too, I would just do the rubber mask thing, forget the makeup and the costume. And I'd do my street with the rubber mask and the pillowcase. And then I'd throw one rubber mask off and put a different rubber mask on and go back and continue to hit the ones till I filled. But you knew, right? I'm going to go to where the people are that have candy. I'm not going to go to the houses where there's no people and no candy. I'm going to go to where the candy is. Go to where lost people are. It's easy, the older we get as Christians, to just start hanging out with each other all the time. And it's a gift and it's a blessing, but we also have eternity together, folks. You know, a statistic that has not changed in my time in ministry, they say that once you've become a Christian for 3 years or more, you've kind of shed all of your non-Christian friends and contacts. Folks, we gotta change that. We gotta go to where the lost folks are and hang out with them. You know, there's a reason that in this country, Islam, right, Muslims, Islam and Jehovah's Witnesses and Mormons, those three faiths are growing exponentially in this country. Bible-believing Christianity is not growing in this country. And I'm not saying we need to follow their methods, but what do we know that Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses do? They knock on doors. I don't know if they've ever come to your door. They've come to mine dozens of times. I love talking to them. But they're going door to door, and it seems to be working. They're going to where lost folks are. We could learn a lesson from that. Again, not saying we need to knock on doors, but I think it comes down to making ourselves available. Again, finding out where lost people are. By the way, statistically in your neighborhood, 9 out of 10 people don't know Jesus. You don't have to go anywhere. Statistically, in your neighborhood, 9 out of 10 people do not know the Lord. There are plenty all around us. It's about making ourselves available. I once heard a preacher say that this life that we're living right now is the equivalent of a short-term missions trip. Think about it. If you've ever been on one, like a weekend long or a 1 week long mission trip, go and do a short term mission trip. When I was a youth pastor, we did them every year. You go for a week and you minister to a people group in a certain city or a certain country, and then you come home. And it's a blessing to them. It's a blessing to you. It's a great experience. But think about eternity and then think about this life. Even if you are blessed with 80 or 90 or more years, it's a blip in eternity. And as a child of God, why are we here? Once you've become saved, why are you still here? Not for you, right? For those who don't yet know Jesus. This life is a short-term missions trip. And so we need to go to where lost people are and make ourselves available in our neighborhood, in our town. What kind of activities can we get involved in our town, in your town? What kind of activities might you be interested in? What kind of clubs do they offer? What kind of sports do they offer that maybe we could get involved in and go where they are? Or just being purposeful and intentional with our neighbors, right? Our children are out of the house, but our neighbors have kids. Maybe I need to get to know my neighbors and go support them and see what their kids like to do and go support those friends and those families. You know, I got my start in ministry with Youth for Christ. I don't know if you're familiar with them. They've been around since the 50s, 1950s, I guess now that we're in 20s. But 1950s, I got started, and I did a thing called Campus Life. Campus Life was a parachurch ministry where you go into a neighborhood where there's a high school, and you try to meet unchurched high school students and lead them to Jesus. So you start with nothing. Like when we hired Connolly, which was before I got here, but Connolly got hired here, and one of the blessings was there was a core group of students. Right, you walk in and there's already kind of a youth group in a church. Well, in the parachurch, you walk in, there's nobody. They just say, hey, we want you to reach Rolling Meadows High School, which was what I was doing. And I'm like, okay, well, where are the volunteers? Where are the students? You gotta go get them. Like I didn't even get a degree in ministry. I was like, what? How do I do that? Start going to football games. Start going to basketball games. Find ways to get involved in the school and you'll start meeting a ton of students. Yeah, it's gonna seem really weird at first. They might think you're weird at first. Try to maybe find a family from a local church you know that goes there and go with them to a game and they can introduce you to people. And that's what I did. That's what I had to do. It was the only way to meet these students who didn't know Christ. I was able to get a job as one of the gymnastics coaches, which was a great opening because now I had hundreds of students I could connect with. But that's how that ministry worked. But I think that's how, again, as we see from the text, that's how life should work as a believer, as a child of God. So therefore, I'm a witness, right? Acts 1:8. We go to where lost folks are. And folks, I get that it can be discouraging at times. It can be hard. People can look at you and say, hey, just stop with the Jesus stuff. I'm done with that. I want to acknowledge that. I've been spit on. I've been yelled at, cussed out, trying to love somebody in Christ's name. I get that it's hard. And I would encourage you to go back to this story. This is the older I get, this has become one of my favorite stories. And it's really through the end of chapter 5, what Peter and John and the disciples would do. But read it later. Folks, this story, we're going to finish reading more of it today, right? They would heal this man that we're going to read about. They would then preach, standing in Solomon's portico. They would then preach to the crowd that is gathered. And they would get arrested. And they would be sternly warned, stop doing this. And they'd be let go. And you know what they'd do the next day? They'd go back to the same exact spot and preach again. And they got arrested again. And then they miraculously got let go by an angel. And then they got arrested. You know what they did? The next day they went back again and preached again in the same spot. Like, not hard to find. The guards were even like, listen, the guys you arrested, they somehow got out, but they're exactly where they were yesterday, so we can just go get them again. And then this time it says that they were beaten before they were released. And you know what they did the next day? And every day after that, they went back to the same place. It hurts when our friends and our loved ones might spit on us or yell at us or reject us. We don't have this though, but let's learn from them and never give up. Let's never stop going, folks. Life gets busy, life gets hectic. Satan is great at distracting us, but we need to never stop going to where lost people are. The Great Commission doesn't expire. Maybe that sounds weird for me to say here, but I guess after ministering in Arizona for years with retirees, where that was actually said to me, hey, I'm retired, John. I don't have to make disciples anymore. What? The Great Commission doesn't expire. Being a witness, it expires the day you enter heaven. But until then, we continue to go where lost people are. The second thing we learn, let's continue, verse 2. It says, and a man lame from birth was being carried, whom they laid dearly at the gate of the temple that is called the Beautiful Gate, to ask alms of those entering the temple. Seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked to receive alms. And Peter directed his gaze at him, as did John, and said, look at us. And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, I have no silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. You can't read that story and not get excited, right? You can't read it and not get excited. But here's this man lame from birth. Now we know from Acts chapter 4 that this man was over 40 years old. So for 40 plus years, just imagine that. For those of you that are in your early 40s right now, imagine never ever having been able to use your legs. He's probably been at the gate 35 years. I don't know, whenever his parents would have started bringing him and leaving him there to get handouts. Maybe close to 40 years he's been at this gate. He can't go in to the temple and worship the God that he believes in. He's not allowed to because he's lame. And so for 35 to 40 years, he's been dropped at this gate and waited for collections. He's been there at this time of day. Again, why? Because of the crowds. That's probably when he's going to get the most money. And what do people do when they come by? Right? They're used to this. The Jewish men and women who are going in, they're used to this. And they're probably not even engaging with the people. Maybe there's a familiarity because he's been there for so long. But they don't engage him. They don't talk to him. They just drop things in their baskets or their cups or whatever they have, and they just keep going. People don't do this. But they did. They decided to stop and engage. You can probably guess this man lost hope. He's just asking for a handout. Not even a hope of being healed or having his life changed, but just hoping he can get enough money to maybe survive for the next day or for the next couple days. The disciples have probably even walked by him before, but as far as we know, never engaged him. And now we have this moment, he's asking for alms, and they stop and they look him eye in the eye. They engage with this man. And I want to read it again. He says, I have no silver and gold, but what I have, I give to you. And in the name of Christ, this man is healed. What do we learn from this? We learn this. Witnesses give what they have. We don't just go to the lost, but when we get there, we give what we have. Does it mean we should suddenly go around and try to start healing everybody? No. Should we pray for healing? Sure, and I'll talk more about that in a second. But what I'm getting at is simply this. It's about caring for the real needs of people. This guy did have a real need that he needed money. He had a bigger need that he needed to be healed. He had an even bigger need that he needed to be saved. But sometimes people have a hard time seeing Jesus when they're so preoccupied with their real needs. And so they met his real need. His biggest real need was the fact that he couldn't walk. And so they healed him. But for us, it's about caring for the real needs of the people around us as we are able, but also remembering Christ is anybody and everybody's biggest need. And it might sound insensitive to somebody who is lame from birth. That might sound insensitive to somebody who's battling cancer or just lost a job or lost a loved one. And I don't want to sound insensitive to that at all. I don't mean to if I do. But folks, every human being's greatest need is salvation. Because apart from that, it's eternity separated from Jesus, which is the worst thing. It's worse than anything we could endure in this life. It's worse than all the bad things we could endure in this life and then some. But we start sometimes by meeting their real needs, giving what we have when we are able, folks. I do want to make a comment about the healing because often we read this and say, well, why doesn't this happen for me? Maybe you've prayed for healing. Talked with a good friend of mine this week whose daughter was in a pretty severe accident this year and she's relearning to walk. And you bet he's been praying for her healing. And he keeps praying for it. He's not going to give up, but he's also not getting discouraged because he's trusting the Lord in it, folks. This story, right, this is the authority of the apostles being affirmed. It's called apostolic authority. So the healing is affirming their authority, the authority given to them by Jesus, but it's also confirming what's called the messianic age. And what I mean by that is this. In Isaiah 35, verse 6, if you're taking notes, it says this, "Then shall the lame man leap like a deer." Sound familiar? That was written 700 years before this happened. And it's considered a prophecy of the times when Christ would be here. When Christ comes, these kind of things are going to happen. Well, Christ came. Christ died and rose again, and now the church is being built. Christ is building his church, and this kind of thing happened. It's not the only time. Acts chapter 14, Paul sees a lame man. You know what happens? And he sprang up and began walking. So these were signs of the messianic age. These were things that were affirming their apostolic authority. They aren't the norm. Again, this is what we call narrative. It's descriptive of what was going on. It's not what we call prescriptive. It doesn't mean this is going to happen to all of us. Does it mean we pray for healing still today? Yes. Yes, we do. Don't ever stop praying for healing. But we need to remember that it's Jesus who heals, not us. And when he does it, by the way, it's complete and it's indisputable. Jesus doesn't heal partially, and that's a sermon for another day, but he doesn't. It's complete and it's indisputable. I've prayed for hundreds of people to be healed in my lifetime. Many have been healed through the gift of medicine, which is a gift from our Lord. I have seen one time it happen miraculously. In a small group we were in Connecticut, a gal had been into the doctor. She had a lump or a mass about an inch and a half big, kind of dead center in her chest. And she was going in the next day to get it biopsied. And so she'd reached out to our elders and her small group and said, "Would you please come," right, James 5, "would you please come and anoint with me oil and pray over me?" And we did. And in that moment, nothing miraculous happened that we felt. It's not about feeling or saw. But the next day when she went in for the biopsy, it was gone. That had nothing to do with us. That had everything to do with Jesus. Jesus did that. And he still does. He doesn't all the time. And I don't know why. It's a question many will ask when we stand before him. So we continue to pray for healing and we continue to trust Jesus. And as far as going to people who don't know him, and maybe we come across somebody who needs healing, we can give what we have, which a lot of times might just be the comfort and the love that they need, right? Think about it. Think about where we are in American history right now. Hope is at an all-time low. Counseling, therapy, depression, anxiety, all-time highs. Medication to help with those things, skyrocketing. We live in a country where hope is disappearing rapidly. And some of us in here are even struggling with it. People, talking about the lost again, though, it's hard to see beyond our real needs sometimes, especially if Christ isn't in our lives. I really don't know how people get through seasons like this without Jesus. I really don't. Some people around us don't think they're worth saving or salvation isn't even on their mind because all they can see is what they need right here and right now, like the lame man. And by caring for them, by simply caring for a neighbor that we know has needs, caring for somebody we work with that maybe nobody else would care for, caring for a friend in school that maybe nobody else would care for, that's the kind of thing that will often open the door to the gospel. You know, I have this friend in Arizona who I learned this lesson from time and time again. His name was Scott. This guy got it. Like, I stand here before you as somebody who needs to become more compassionate, so you're welcome to pray that for me. I've never been the most compassionate guy, so why the Lord called me in to be a pastor without giving me compassion, I don't know. That's up, talk to him. I keep asking for more of it. But I had a friend in Arizona who was awesome at it, and so I was like, I need to hang out with you because I need to learn this. And he was incredible. I lost track of the number of times he'd call. Hey, John, I just heard so-and-so is in the hospital. You want to come with me and go pray for them? That's how we could meet their need right now. Hey, John, I just found out, I got this neighbor of mine who's trying to paint his house, and his wife's sick, and he just got hurt, and he really isn't able to do it. So I was going to get some guys and go paint for him. You want to come with me? Hey, John, this other guy I know in town, he's got a neighbor moving in. Like, I don't even know this guy, but I told him I'd get a bunch of guys to go help move this guy in. I just talked to Scott about a month ago, and he was telling me about a mutual friend of ours. He's like, hey, do you remember so? I was like, of course I remember this guy. We hung out all the time. He goes, hey, I just got word they're getting divorced. He goes, I've been spending time with him each week, just sitting down over coffee and listening to his story. Scott is phenomenal at this, and he's taught me a lot, but that's what we're talking about. What are the real needs of the folks around you? And guys, more often than not, by the way, it might have nothing to do with giving them food or money or even helping them with yard work. All good things, by the way. It might simply have to do with paying attention to them, folks. One of the greatest things you can do in our culture right now is pay attention to somebody. Talk to them. Go back to the text. What did it say? Right? They were walking by this man, and instead of just walking by and dropping money or dropping all kinds of gold in his bucket, they stopped because they knew his issue wasn't gold. It was bigger than that. And they looked him in the eye. This doesn't happen. You need to understand the weight of this. This doesn't happen. People don't pay attention to the lame. The Jewish people thought these people were beneath them, and they looked him in the eye and they said, look at us. And he looked at them excitedly, expectantly. Wait, what? You want to look at me? You want to talk to me? Do you know how often that's the best thing we can do? Is pay attention to somebody? Grab a cup of coffee with somebody and just listen to their story. Don't preach at them, just listen to their story. That alone will open so many doors to actually give them the gospel. By giving them what you can in the moment, you then can maybe, hopefully, prayerfully give them the gospel. Another friend of mine shared a great idea that he did when he moved into his neighborhood. He went to every neighbor, like within a block or two radius, typed up a little card and just said, hey, I just wanted to introduce myself. I'm your new neighbor. Here's my name, my phone number, my email. If you ever need anything, any help in any way, shape, or form, give me a call. What a great way just to start the conversation with your neighbors. Maybe providing meals. My Amy is awesome at this. Every neighborhood we've ever lived in, and I'm sure she'll probably do it this Christmas. No, she's gonna look at me and go, John, I have to say this. But she does this. You ever heard of biscotti? I don't like it, but she does. Some of you are like, ooh, biscotti. Like biscotti and scones. Amy makes really, really good ones, I've been told. Well, I say that, not she's a phenomenal cook. I just don't happen to like those things. And every Christmas, she's making baggies of biscotti and scones and cards and delivering to, I get to look good because I go with her and we deliver them to our neighbors. If we haven't met them yet, we get to meet them. This is where it's that simple. Just start talking to people. More often than not, in those conversations, you'll find out what their needs are, if it goes beyond maybe a friendship. And I get that maybe some of us, again, are scared, but let's follow the example of the witnesses who've gone before us. And oh, by the way, we're called to do this, but we get to do this. This is part of our salvation. It's part of the gift of God. We get to help introduce others to Christ. If you're really maybe nervous to do it by yourself, grab your spouse, grab somebody from your small group. Better yet, come here on Saturday morning and help at our Hope Center. If you've never been, you are missing a beautiful, sweet time of doing exactly this, meeting the real needs of families who are in a tough season. I go once a month and I love it. I absolutely love it. And a team that we have that does this week in, week out, great group of men and women. And this is that's what the Hope Center is for, folks. Look at the text again real quick. One more thing I'll point out before we get to the third. Verse 7, I love this. He proclaims Christ over this man's lame abilities and says, he took him by the right hand and raised him up. And immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. I love that imagery, right? If you think about it, somebody, how many times have we done this in life? Somebody's sitting on the ground, hey, help me up. And you lean in and you grab the right hand and you, as you lean back, you pull them up. As a guy who has had back issues since I was 12, I need that often. Right? When you can't get up and you have to be helped up. This is a guy who for the first time in his life was getting helped up. But when we say that witnesses give what you have, that's all we're talking about. Who right now in your neighborhood or in your workplace or at the gym that you frequent or wherever you are maybe involved in your town already, who can you maybe help up right now? Just give them, just extend your hand to help them up. If you don't know, maybe it's going back to step one and re-engaging with the lost. But as we do, it's gonna be easy to find out where we can help people up. Always in the hopes and the prayer, right, that they're coming to know Jesus, because that's the greatest need. The third thing we can learn, last few verses. Verse 8 says this, and leaping up, he stood. I love that. He didn't just help him up, right? Just stop for a second. Like, this is the imagery. Like, Peter's reaching a hand down to pull the guy up. And it says that as he leaned back to lift him, like, the guy leaped. Like, the imagery is that he jumped, like, as high as he could possibly jump. You talk about an instantaneous, miraculous healing. The legs haven't worked in 40 plus years, and this guy is jumping 5 feet off the ground. Peter's got like a human kite for 5 seconds. That's what just happened here. I love this, but it goes on, right? Leaping up, he stood and began to walk and entered the temple, catch that. Never been able to do that. Entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and what? And praising God. And all the people saw him, here we go, walking and what? And praising God, and recognized him as the one who sat at the beautiful gate of the temple asking for alms. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. We're told twice that he's praising God. That's not an accident, right? Every word is written here intentionally and purposely from God. And he wanted to make sure we saw that twice it's noted that this man was praising God. By the way, if you read the rest of the story this week, I'd encourage you, read Acts 3, 4, and 5. When you find out about their first arrest and they finally stand before the Pharisees and Sadducees, you know who's standing right here? This guy, standing right next to him. So either he was arrested with them and spent the night in prison, or he made sure he was there the next morning when they were being questioned, standing in their defense. This guy praising God for what has just happened to him. Because he can stand? Sure. Because he's healed? Sure. Because he can enter the temple? Sure. Why? But mostly because God did this. Through Jesus, God did this, right? What do we say at Harvest when somebody shares their testimony? When you share your story of God at work in your life, right? I was lost and without Jesus, but God showed up and I found Jesus. And now, right? I was, but God, and now. This guy is running around in the temple. I love this, right? It's full of Jewish men and women trying to pray. And here's this guy who's been lame for 40-something years, running around, probably interrupting their prayers. Hey, I was lame. Did you see me? You walk by me every day for 40 years. Look at me. Look what God did. Uncontainable. Peter and John are probably just laughing. And a crowd gathered like, holy cow, what's going on? And he just, praise God. Praise God, I was, but God, and now I can walk. I can walk because of Jesus. Do you see this? Like, I love that. I love that imagery. He couldn't contain it. And by the way, you know what would happen? 2,000 more people would get saved. At least. It says that the number went up to 5,000. All because of this moment. Because they were willing to go where the lost was and give what they have. And in the love, the third point we actually learn from the lame man, from our new brother in Christ, right? Is this. Witnesses glorify God always. And you might say, well, John, that's easy. This guy hadn't walked in 40 plus years. It's easy when everything goes your way to praise God. Yes, it is. And so we need to remember that's why it's always. We praise God whether somebody gets healed or not. Whether our loved one gets healed or not, we praise God. We praise God whether someone comes to know Jesus or not. if maybe this is stirring in you a desire to get back out there and you start re-engaging with lost men and women and you start caring for them and they're not coming to Jesus yet, we still praise God. You might share the gospel with a neighbor and they might say, that's not for me, but I'm glad for you. We praise God still. The gospel is going out, right? What are we called to do? Plant water. God makes it grow. Pastor Jeff has made that very clear in this sermon series. God is the one who saves. God is the one who heals. And so we praise him, first of all, for who he is and what he's done, but we praise him when we're faithful also and when the gospel goes forth. When God does something, we glorify. When God doesn't do it your way, but he still does it his way, we glorify. Let me ask you a question. Right, it's easy to read this story and get excited with this man. Is God still working in your life? It's a resounding yes, by the way. And I get that there are seasons when it's hard to see it. I get there are seasons that it seems distant. I've had many of those. But he is. He's never stopped. Philippians reminds us that God is working in us. Until the day that we stand before Christ, God will complete the good work that he began in us, the day he saved us. He hasn't stopped. He will not stop this side of heaven to work in us and through us. But why is it so often we lose our excitement? How about, I mean, for our salvation alone. I don't know how long this guy ran around and screamed and shouted and praised God. I hope it's for the rest of his life. But why do we do that, right? When you get saved at 3 or 4 or 5, sometimes it's tougher to really remember the moment. I got saved at 14. I remember it vividly. Second by second, I remember the moment I got saved. When I really truly spend time to reflect on it, I get all excited again. But I don't wake up every day excited about it. Why not? I should. Shouldn't I? I think there's two main reasons we don't wake up every day excited why we're saved. So I just want to touch on those briefly. And I think one is that we can get easily, not easily, but we can be overwhelmed with life. If you are in a difficult season right now, or if you've been in one, you know what I mean. When it just feels like maybe everything is against you, when nothing seems to be going the way you had hoped or planned, when illnesses pop out of the woodwork, when job losses pop up, COVID has multiplied all of this in our lives. We can get over, and when you're overwhelmed, it's hard to see God. Those are those seasons when, God, where are you? God, what are you doing? If you talked to me a year ago, this is where I was. Amy and I had poured our life into that church in Arizona and feeling like it was moving in the direction of possibly closing. We had thought this was the last church I'd ever have to pastor till the day I'm old and gray. God, this is gonna be wonderful and I'm so excited. We left the training center in 2015 or 2016, so excited to go back and pastor this church thinking this is gonna be it. We get to do this till we're old and gray and then hand it off to some great young guy. And there we were last summer going, God, what are you doing? Have you left us? Did you forget about this church you helped us start? Are you not building your church anymore? Sometimes it's hard. It's hard to see God. And what keeps coming to my mind, what I've learned last summer, I was reminded of and continue to come to my mind when I have days like that. Acts 16. If you're overwhelmed, by the way, go back and read the story in Acts 16 later today. Paul and Silas are in prison. They're arrested for preaching the gospel. Something we don't have to fear in this country. They're arrested for preaching the gospel. Not the first time Paul would be arrested. Excuse me, it might've been the first, but not the last time Paul would be arrested. Paul would spend years chained to a guard even. Acts 16 verse 5, while in prison, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God. It's easy to get overwhelmed sometimes. When we get overwhelmed, we need to make sure we focus. We need to go and find, when it's hard to see God, go and find him. How do we do that? Get back in his word. Be reminded of who he is. Psalm 23, right? A great reminder. If we're feeling overwhelmed, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you think he feels overwhelmed? I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Psalm 59, the author wrote this, "Oh, my strength, I will sing praises to you, for you, O God, are my fortress, the God who shows me steadfast love." You feeling overwhelmed? Start reciting every verse you know about our great and awesome God who never leaves you, who never forsakes you, who's always with you, who's using everything in your life for his, your good and his glory. And let's remember too in James 1, right? It says, again, you know, Paul would talk about joy in Philippians, again, a letter he would write from prison. But James, right, in the beginning of his book, the brother of Jesus, says, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. Why? Because God's going to use these trials so that, it says, you may be perfect, complete, lacking in nothing. If maybe you've been overwhelmed in this season, follow Paul and Silas's example. Do your best to sing praises, or just at least say them out loud or recite them out loud. Remember the truths of God's word. This isn't just a book. It's not just an app on your phone. This is the word of the living God, written by his hand through these various men so that we would have it today and not be overwhelmed. The second reason I think we lose our excitement is this. We just simply forget. You may not be overwhelmed, but life is busy. Life is crazy. There's a million things going on. And depending on your stage of life, all the kids that you might have and all the activities they might have, or maybe it's unemployment, right? All the things that are going on, we just simply forget. You know, I came across a book a few years ago, and the whole premise of the book is to preach the gospel to yourself every day. You can do it in simple sentences. Just remind myself when I get up in the morning, man, I'm saved. I'm justified. I'm redeemed. I was chosen. I was predestined. And then God still saved me after all that. And I'm sanctified, and I'm adopted, and I'm sealed, and I'm empowered. This is what my God does for me. This is who I am every day. Sometimes just saying that when I get up in the morning, it changes my entire day. I do get a little bit more excited to go find somebody and tell them about Jesus. Folks, we need to never stop being amazed at what God is doing in our life. Never stop being amazed and in awe of who our great God is, that he saves and he heals and he sanctifies and he seals for all eternity. You know, I kind of made fun of some of my retirees a little earlier in Arizona, but one of the fun things I loved about them, you have a lot of grandparents in Arizona, right? And you could tell the brand new grandparents, because if they were brand new grandparents, they never, like, all they talked about was the new grandkid. It's all they talked about. Like, our neighbors were really dear, sweet friends of ours, and their first grandson was born 2 years ago. And our last year and a half before we moved with them, all I heard about was his grandson. Hey, how you doing, Dave? Great, let me show you what the baby did. I watched more pictures and saw more videos of their grandson. They're so excited. And that excitement doesn't seem to fade for grandparents. Hey, can I tell you about my nephew? He just made honor roll. Or not my nephew, my grandson just made honor roll. My granddaughter, she's gonna like speak at her graduation commencement. Oh, my twins just both got accepted. My twin grandkids just got accepted to college. Grandparents don't stop talking about their grandkids. Let's never stop talking about Jesus. He is working. Even if you're in that dark season, he's the one sustaining you. He's the one getting you through that difficult season right now. Let's learn from the lame man and recognize that God has done amazing, amazing things in our lives. One last story I'll tell you too, because this is one of the sweet things from Arizona, many sweet things in Arizona. I had a friend named Charlie. I met Charlie when he was turning 80. He passed away when he was about 86 or 87. Charlie told everybody he's ever met in his entire life about Jesus. I'm not kidding. And I can at least affirm the 7 years that I knew him. I have no doubt he's done it every day. Charlie wrote his own little Bible tract that included his story and carried a stack of them in his pocket every day of his life. And if he was at Starbucks, the barista got one of Charlie's tracts and he made sure she knew who Jesus was. Charlie was at the checkout counter at the Safeway. That checkout person was gonna hear about Jesus. Charlie battled cancer 4 times. 3 times the Lord healed him using medicine. Every nurse, every doctor, every candy striper that came into that room heard the story of Jesus. The 4th time, cancer won. Although Charlie won because he's with Jesus. But even when he was in hospice at home, every nurse that came in to bathe him or help him heard about Jesus. Charlie never lost his excitement. Folks, we've all been sent. We've been sent. We get to do this. This is a gift. This is a privilege. It's not a chore. It's not a have to. This is what you're saved for, by the way. And if we're not doing what we're saved for, expect to not be happy. If you're not doing what you're saved for and what you're made for by God, expect to not be content and happy in this life. Expect to not be satisfied because we're not doing what we get to do and what we've been saved for. The only difference between the men and the women I mentioned earlier, Amy Carmichael and Nate Saint, is that they went to a foreign country. We get to do it here. I don't have to go to a foreign country, but I get to do it here, folks. Only Jesus can save, and he will. Only Jesus can heal, and oftentimes he will. But we get to go to lost people. We get to share everything we have in the hopes that they come to know Jesus. And we get to glorify God every single day of our lives. Amen? Would you stand with me as we pray? Father, thank you for this reminder. I know I needed it this week. I needed to be reminded of what it looks like to live as a witness, to live as a child of yours. God, what you have done for me and for every one of us is far greater than we could ever ask or imagine. Salvation alone is the greatest thing that could happen in our lives. And I know I will ask this for me, Lord. Forgive me that I lose my excitement for that. Forgive me that I let the distractions of this life quench my zeal for my salvation, Lord. There's nothing greater that could ever happen to me or us this side of heaven than to be saved. And because of that, we are sealed for all eternity as your children, God. Thank you for this reminder. And God, I pray that you would use it here this morning with my church family, with every one of us that is here. Stir in us a zeal for our salvation. Stir in us a zeal for your kingdom and for your glory. Stir in us compassion for the lost, Jesus. Matthew 9 tells us that you had compassion on the lost, Jesus. Give us your compassion. God, we get to do this. We get to go where lost men and women are. We get to give them what we have, including the gospel. We get to give you glory by proclaiming our story and what you're doing in our lives over and over again. We get to do this. So give us the courage, give us the boldness, give us what we need so that we will. I pray for any of my brothers and sisters who are overwhelmed in this season, God. Help them to see you. Help them to know your presence, to know your strength and your comfort and your peace and your joy, Jesus. Move in all of us in such a way that we can't help but tell everybody we meet about our Savior, Jesus. Thank you. In your great name, Jesus. Amen.